Hi, everyone. Welcome to April's IdeaFlow. As Daza mentioned earlier, we're going to be talking about independent algorithmic auditing. And we'll be joined by Ryan Carrier. Ryan is the founder, executive director, and chairman for Humanity. He's had over 25 years of experience in business and finance and risk management expertise. And this has given him this really unique perspective in thinking about how to manage risks regarding algorithms and all the things that Daza talked about earlier. And today, Ryan will be talking to us about what algorithmic auditing even is, what his vision for a future in which we need these sorts of audits are. And then we'll be later on joined by me, Daza, and David, and we'll have like a brief conversation about some ideas we have about auditing as well. So I'll give the floor to Ryan right now to get us started.
Thanks, TMA. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm looking forward to the discussion. The background on For Humanity is I started as a nonprofit about 5 years ago and wrote a lot of words about future of work, technological unemployment, rights and freedoms in the fourth industrial revolution, ownership of data, just really covered the spectrum of risks associated with AI autonomous systems on humanity. But the one that I settled on that was kind of most, I think, relevant, impactful, and had a robust track record of sort of action is this concept of independent audit of AI systems, bringing forward this idea of a trustworthy system or inbuilt trust. And what some people don't realize is that in finance, we have this 50-year track record of third-party independent audits. And the trust that that brings to the equation is really robust. People build entire businesses, entire business models and industries on top of these financial audits and accounting without even extra thought. They receive these financial reports and simply execute, they deploy. And so it really is a high degree of trust built into the system because of the way the system operates in terms of checks and balances, eliminating conflict of interest, ensuring independence and objectivity. And so what we want to do is we want to replicate those same features, that same construct of trust into AI and autonomous systems in five key areas: ethics, bias, privacy, trust, and cybersecurity. And in doing so, what we need to do is we need to craft auditable rules. And auditable rules have some key features, such as having to be binary. And so the art to what we are working on, for example, is we aren't kings and we aren't legislators unto ourselves. In fact, recently I was having a conversation with someone at the GSA at the federal level of the US federal government. And he said, "Oh, really? What you are is a secretariat." And I really like that nomenclature for what we are doing, which is we're drawing together. We're now over 325 people from 42 countries, with 32 fellows, and we are crowdsourcing audit criteria. But what we do is we turn this into these audit rules, these binary compliance almost checklists. But we submit them back to the regulators, the governing bodies, the authorities, and basically say, "Are you good? Does this represent what you mean? Or maybe we didn't quite get it right. Send it back to us and we'll rebuild and fix and iterate." And that's the crowdsourcing nature of the process. But in the end, we're really just providing a service to these governments to take the law. So take GDPR as an example, right? It's the law, it sits there. We have crafted an audit criteria at the request of the Information Commissioner's Office of the UK, so who is still governed by GDPR. Now the law sits there, and what happens is someone might go out and break it on purpose, accident, doesn't matter, right? They break the law. And so what they do is they get smacked over the head with the law, right? They get punished by the law, they pay a fine or whatever. But unfortunately, when that happens, humans are already damaged in that equation, right? The law has been broken, privacy's been broken, somebody's been hurt. And so what we can change about that, or what we can improve upon with that, is if you take the GDPR and you turn it into a set of auditable criteria, and you require the audits in advance, now you can generate better, more frequent, proactive compliance with the law before people are hurt. We would argue it's a better application of the law. And we've seen this in finance, where tax code and markets-based law are very frequently complied with because they're embedded into these third-party independent audits. And so really what we want to replicate is that mechanism, that proactivity, especially into AI and autonomous systems where, well, with the exception of the recent new EU regs and GDPR, kind of still remains the Wild West in terms of oversight, governance, accountability, and so on. So that's what we hope to bring. We are growing like crazy. When Daza and I first met almost exactly 12 months ago, For Humanity was me. and now we're 325 people and growing at sort of 80 to 100 a month. We'll be 500 in a few weeks, and we'll be 1,000 by the fall, all focused on people. We don't invite corporations in. We don't invite governments in. People can come and bring those perspectives. That's fantastic. But what we are is we're built from people up, and the rules and criteria we set are meant to protect people through the enhancement of governance, oversight, accountability, and trust. So that's really the nutshell, I think. Hopefully it's a decent overview of what we're trying to do.
Outstanding. Thank you so much for providing that very crisp overview, Ryan. And the first thing I want to do is just reflect that you have my audit of your remarks is suggest that you've successfully modeled what we have in mind by a flash talk, which is, you know, and it's hard to encapsulate so much in such a small nugget. But the idea is to use that to catalyze questions, conversation, maybe new ideas. So with that in mind, I'll go ahead and I'll maybe try to, you know, throw the first lightning bolt and see if we can get started. So I wonder, when we talk about audit and especially independent audit, number one, why does it matter if the audit's independent versus in-house? Like, couldn't you have your in-house auditors apply the same rules, or maybe not even not auditors, like just, you know, whatever, security consultants or, you know, program managers, just have it be part of their, you know, security and, you know, compliance checklists that they do? Like, what's so special or important about the independent audit? Setting you up here a little bit. And then number two, how can you objectively measure that you've got the criteria right, especially when you're crowdsourcing it in a sense? Like, how can you connect a successful audit finding to ensuring the results that we want? In other words, avoiding the bias and avoiding the anomalous harm to people as a result of reliance on AI systems. Those are my two kind of starting questions.
Two massive questions. so we'll come back to the criteria and sort of the process a second. But when we talk about audit, there are multiple kinds of audit. We put out a piece called Taxonomy about 3-4 months ago. And taxonomy explains the difference between internal audits, independent third-party audits, assurance, and assessments. And the reason we had to do that is there were people already in the marketplace in AI saying, we do AI audits, and it's a misnomer, or it's a misstatement, or it's a misappropriation of the term. An assessment or what's currently going on is we have firms with speciality who are engaging companies, and they create a feedback loop and a process for evaluating and improving systems. Very valuable. There's no criticism of that in any way, shape, or form. But that feedback loop and that even contractual relationship is between the entity and the company, okay? And that's called an assessment. Remember, we have a 50-year track record of these words and these terms being used over here in finance. So just because AI is new and cool doesn't mean they get to steal words and use them the wrong way. So assessment is what's happening over here. Audit is very unique, especially when we use it with a capital A. Audit requires three key features that do not exist anywhere else, internal or as an assessment. Auditors, number one, are certified practitioners, of which there are none currently in the AI world. Number two, when you do an audit, it has to be on an independent third-party set of rules. And the third part, and this is what most people don't realize about audit, audit is a very special contract. It's actually a three-party contract. So auditors do their work on a target of evaluation. They do not work for that target of evaluation. They do their work over the target of evaluation. And instead, they do their work on behalf of intended users, or more often, the public, which is why they're called certified public accountants. Most people don't realize that's where the word public comes from. That's who the work is actually done for. It creates a beautiful tension between the target of evaluation and the auditor. And that tension is where we build this infrastructure of trust. When I come in, let's say I were the auditor and I come in, Daza, to audit your firm. And you say, we've got a new algorithmic system. I'm like, great. Did you set up the algorithmic risk committee? And you're like, yep, Megan and Renata and Walter, they're on the algorithmic risk committee with me. And I smile at you and I know we're gonna go get lunch later. You know, we've been doing this for years, but I gotta lean in and I gotta do this. I gotta say, Daza, you gotta prove it to me. Why is that? Why do you have to prove it to me? Because as your auditor, as an auditor who has a responsibility to the public, if I assert false compliance, if I assert compliance where it does not exist, do you know who's liable for that? Me. And that's what's different between this assessment and this internal conversation on how I'm improving your system, right? There's no liability associated with that. When I'm an auditor of a proper third-party audit, I do have liability if I assert false compliance. So I need to know, I need to have it proved that you have complied with what the audit rules and criteria are. And so that also highlights why audit rules are unique and special. We can't have gray areas, because if there's a gray area with an audit compliance or question, then what am I going to say? I'm going to say non-compliant because it protects me, right? So the nature of this audit relationship, this lovely tension here, is I can get no other remunerations from you, right? I cannot do pre-audit service. This is Sarbanes-Oxley. We learned this from Enron and WorldCom in 2001. I get no other remunerations. I get only the fees associated with providing the audit. And I wear liability for false compliance if it doesn't exist. When that system is created, when I'm independent, legal term independent, when I am objective, then if I assert compliance, if the auditor asserts compliance, the public can hear that and basically say, yeah, they probably are compliant. You know why? Because there's no reason for me to provide compliance where it doesn't exist. There's no remuneration, no other way to achieve that sort of a benefit. Now, no system prevents fraud and malfeasance. So fraud and malfeasance can still occur. Enron proved that, right? But the system still had sufficient checks, balances, disclosures, transparency, et cetera, that enabled Enron to eventually be caught out. And then with Sarbanes-Oxley, we enhanced the system and made it even better and even more robust to avoid, because what happened, some of you may not know, Arthur Andersen was both the auditor and the pre-audit service provider. And so they're complying with their own rules. And this is why you have to have that independent third-party set of rules. So if you have the auditor, you may not be the pre-audit service provider. If you're the pre-audit service provider, you may not be the auditor. That's the law, okay? But here's the other part of this. If you're either one of these things, you know what you don't get to do? You can't make your own rules, be a conflict of interest. And therefore we need an independent third-party set body who's creating those rules. That's the role For Humanity aims to play in this equation. On behalf of people, create a set of criteria that are submitted to regulators, legislators, whoever the legal authority is, to basically say, does this represent your views? And if it does, then these audit criteria can be used. We would license it out to any qualified auditors, any qualified service providers, who can provide these solutions. And then Daza, you also mentioned about internal audit. Internal audit is something that grew out of the original financial audit, which was for 20 years, once the SEC mandated 10 Qs and 10 Ks, right? auditors would walk in and every company reacted the same way. It's like, it's the auditors. Like, it was going to be a bad doctor's visit, right? It's going to be painful. The Treadway Commission came along and created the COSO system of internal risk and controls, and it changed how we respond to auditors. So now they walk in, external auditors, they walk in, we usher them up to the third floor conference room. We lock the door on them for 6 weeks. We slide food under the door 3 times a day, and we pump compliance at them, right? It's a much easier system when it's built compliance by design. And that's the role that the internal auditors play. They build this system so that they know that the internal solutions that feeds this funnel are objective and independently verified before they're handed off to the internal auditors. So internal auditors play a hugely valuable role in terms of meeting external auditors in a non-painful way. So that was like 2/3 of your question. I'm wondering if I should take a pause or if we should circle back.
Yeah, pause is probably good. And the second part, if I may, TMA, related to having a rational basis for establishing what the audit criteria are, especially using this additional innovation of crowdsourcing. Which is, you know, not how I think of GAAP and IFRS rules coming, particularly like the other, you know, source of audit rules. So to that, though, there's a CRISPR question that has been posed by Walter, who's in our batter's box to go next. But first, I wanted to hand it, open the floor to TMA, who is about to say something, and also possibly David Horrigan, if he has anything to interject at this point before we get into further questions.
Yeah, I was just, when you were mentioning the role that For Humanity is going to have, it sounds like For Humanity's role will be similar to that of FASB. And I was wondering, what would the, which government agency do you see be playing the role of the SEC, right? Helping create the laws that are going to enforce, you know, auditing for algorithms?
Yeah, it's a fantastic question. I would characterize FASB.
Could I just ask? Could you please, for the uninitiated, just break down FASB and who they are and how they relate to, you know, the creation of like GAAP and everything,
Absolutely.
Maybe GASB too in the government context. And then to the extent we've had any other acronyms, people should just come off mute and be like, what were you talking about? And let's just have a moment of definition from Ryan so we can all move forward together.
Yeah. Okay. So there's a few that we've probably already used. GAAP, which is Generally Accepted Accounting Principles. IFRS, which is International Financial Reporting Standards. Those are the two main accounting schemes that are used for independent third-party financial audits. GAAP was the original. It's created about 6 months in advance of the precursor of IFRS, which was an iterated process. GAAP was established, and I'm going to kind of tease to what you said, by a crowd, but it was a crowd of white dudes who met at a country club and who worked in the accounting industry. So what I would call these days as a bad crowd, okay? Not necessarily diverse points of views here, but they had a mission, which was to take these disparate accounting concepts and to blend them into a uniform system. And they did a decent job of that. And what they establish from that work is FASB, Financial Accounting Standards Board. FASB is the ownership or governance of generally accepted accounting principles. So when they have to be changed and updated because tax laws change or markets laws change, then they have to they adjust those, build those in, have a, you know, sort of public hearing time where people can file opinions and so on, and interpret decisions and move from there to making the changes in the accounting system. We aim to play that same role, but to be a more robust, transparent, inclusive crowd. And so, and also those people who started FASB and started GAAP accounting, we're from the industry, and it wasn't an all-inclusive kind of thing. Whereas for us, literally anyone can come and join the party and have their voice heard. So we think it's actually a more robust process. Now, once GAAP accounting was established and the industry had agreed it, which they had, within 18 months, the SEC mandated that GAAP accounting had to be followed by all publicly traded companies. And it created this whole industry, what is now a big four, but obviously there's a lot more accountants doing third-party independent financial audits. It created this industry and this mandate, and that was replicated the world around very quickly within a couple of years. Most markets, most stock markets and individual countries had similar kinds of mandates to follow either GAAP or IFRS. Now, who is the SEC in the equation of AI and autonomous systems? Well, I'll tell you a quick funny story, which was I was having the conversation with the senior legislative aide of Pete Olson, who sits on the AI caucus. And we were talking about independent audit, and he stopped me in the middle and he said, "Ryan, who's responsible for this?" And my answer was, "Damned if I know." Because here's the problem. AI and autonomous systems exist across the whole economy in every different place. And I'm just going to give you a quick rundown of conversations that we've had. EEOC cares about AI and hiring. Had a conversation with the Federal Reserve, who cares about credit worthiness. FTC is trying to put in place coverage for children, let alone they're probably the biggest footprint in the space. We're already doing work with the Joint Artificial Intelligence Center of the DoD, who's been tasked with taking AI ethics principles and turning them into auditable criteria for every AI and every autonomous system that they cover. GSA cares, VA cares, pretty much everybody cares. NIST is kind of sitting in the center of this because they're kind of the cool kid in terms of technology, but even then they don't create auditable rules. So the answer is, poof, who knows in the US? So part of our approach at For Humanity is to try and talk to all of them, to try to put out there that we're happy to provide this service, this secretariat service of trying to craft these criteria, trying to translate law, which is not written in a binary way, into these binary, measurable, unambiguous kind of criteria. And again, then resubmitting it back to the authorities. So in the end, Daza, if I took a guess as to who's going to own this, it's going to be a triumvirate, I think. It's going to be FTC, it's going to be NIST, and DoD is going to be kind of allowed to play their part as such a dominant sort of fixture in this. But I think NIST and FTC are probably going to lead the way.
So, you know, one of the things about freedom of speech is we never want to compel speech. It's not just about censorship, but so I'll just make this as an invitation with no pressure. But Mr. Horrigan, as part of your debut splashdown as our co-host going forward, do you have any like reflections or thoughts or questions on what Ryan's laying out?
Absolutely. And once again, thanks for having me, Daza. And Ryan, I thought it was fascinating. The idea of regulating the robots is always something interesting based on the work that I do I'm an in-house counsel for a software company, but do a lot of continuing legal education courses and speaking on data privacy, data protection, and the limits of AI, because we use it to go through people's very personal data in litigation. And one of the things that is interesting, you mentioned a lot of international perspectives here. And as you were talking, I kept thinking, you know, this is all great and it would be great to have a standard and it would be great to be able to have this independent auditing function. But what do you think is the chance of international bodies agreeing to this? Because, you know, you take the use of artificial intelligence in litigation, it's been relatively kumbaya, surprisingly so. When the United States was the first to allow litigants to use technology-assisted review, machine learning, to go through documents as so that lawyers could stand up and do their certification under the federal rules and say, well, yes, we have reviewed the corpus of documents, even though it was the robots really reviewing a lot of the documents. So the United States was first to accept that. Ireland followed, the United Kingdom followed, Australia followed. But U.S. litigation is extremely controversial with the French, especially, as you probably know. So what do you think the chances are of getting people to come around and agree to this? I mean, you know how the GDPR worked, and maybe California agrees with the CCPA and the CPRA, but I don't know about the rest of the country. What do you think?
No, you're absolutely right. And so our focus is 100% on jurisdictionally sensitive criteria. So GDPR is the law of some lands, and therefore we have a criteria that suits that. We could create a California-oriented criteria very quickly, which would be similar, but not the same. But let's use one of the more important issues, which is protected category variables, as defined by civil rights, the Civil Rights Act of 64. Protected category variables define a whole set of things, including bias and EEOC kind of issues. A lot of the world will agree on some of the basics of what these protected category variables are, but there is no chance anytime in the near future or even a distant future, I can imagine, where all jurisdictions will agree on what are protected category variables. For example, in the UK, socioeconomic status is a protected category variable. Definitely not in the United States, right? So even if we agree on everything, right? Race, age, color, gender, sexual orientation, whatever it is, right? We're still going to have these little differences that are going to exist because of legacy systems or because of just even differences in culture. So we make no attempt. We're not out there trying to make a global standard. I think it's a silly approach, to be honest. So instead, all of our criteria will be jurisdictionally sensitive. Now, the net result of that is 20, 30, 50, 60, maybe even 70% of it will be highly similar or even the same. But we're always going to have tweaks around the edges to fit, again, whatever the local law is. And let's take GDPR. There are elements of the US Congress who laugh at GDPR. The right to be forgotten is just hilarious to people, okay? At least in some political parties. But it's the law for GDPR. So what that tells you is GDPR as it stands now has zero chance of ever happening in the United States. But it doesn't mean that large chunks of it can't come through and have started to come through, whether it's in California, New York State's Privacy Act, which is being considered, and in other jurisdictions where they're starting to take on pieces of this, which are highly valuable. And so our approach will always be to serve the whatever local jurisdiction, whatever that means. And over time, because we will do this all around the world, and we will, and it's a lot of hard work, but we'll do it because it's important, you'll begin to see a normalization. Where are the things that we agree on? 40, again, like I said, 30, 40, 50% of it we may agree completely on. But we're always going to have those little bits around the edges for certain that are never going to be normalized. Does that answer the question, David?
Absolutely. Thanks.
Hi, I'm not sure who was speaking. What was it? Could you introduce yourself?
I think that was an accident, but
oh, that's perfectly fine. If my connection's poor, if I suddenly stop, David or Tammy, can you please take the reins? But I see that Bev and Walter had some questions as well. So let's, in no particular order, but Bev, did you want to pose your question first on basically the role of the auditor in this new term that you've seen with respect to second parties?
Sure. I often audit cybersecurity policies in regards to like ISO and other SOC type audits. And I came across this use of second party audit. I had never heard that before. And I wondered if you knew what it was. And if you did, if you could tell me. And if there is a second party audit, is there a first party audit or a fourth party audit? Where does this origin of use of a third party audit come from? Thank you.
Yeah, so first party, I know, is internal audit or some sort of self-reflection, right? Third party, I think, comes from this nature of the ability to analyze the difference between or the interaction between two parties and have a third party independently review that transaction. So that gives you third party. Second party, not sure I know what that is. I'm not going to try to pretend that I think I do. I'm not certain what that would be. So I can't provide any further advice than that.
I could hazard a guess, which is in contracts that I've been involved with in the last several years, especially with security audit. There's frequent, and I'm thinking the insurance industry and some other places, there's standard terms that require or permit the other contracting party in a B2B relationship to audit compliance or other assertions of their counterparty. Okay. So, you know, perhaps it's a partner or a contractual counterparty, maybe. I don't know. I'm just guessing here.
That makes sense. And we actually have that. So one of the provisions in our licensing arrangements is that when we license out to auditors, there's a couple of things that we want to keep them from doing. Number one, we want to keep an auditor from also being a service provider. So we want to be able to understand what their revenue stream is and with whom. So we have an audit right in the license to basically check on people to see if they're getting excess remunerations from an entity that they should be pristine with. So that's actually one part. And another part is as this industry begins to mature, what will naturally happen is a pre-audit service provider is going to pass. They're going to say, oh, you should go get audited by this group, right? Because there's just not going to be that many people out there and many entities out there that can do that. So also built into the provision is into the license is as this grows, we want to make sure that there's diversity so that it's not always, you know, I'm this pre-audit service provider. I'm going to send everything to this auditor because I know they're going to be good. Right. That's again, we view that as kind of a collusive factor or some measure of conflict of interest. So built into our audit criteria is that you must have a diversity of either pre-audit service providers or if you're pre-audit of end resulting auditors as the industry grows and matures. So again, that might be an example of second party audit. We have those audit rights to kind of ensure fulfillment of the contractual obligations.
Got it. Thank you. And Walter, thank you. Walter, you had a question with respect to the crowdsourcing and maybe other places it could be applicable.
Yeah. So from my understanding from your talk is that you were focused on kind of retrofitting already existing kind of laws and forming them into binary checklists that for the independent auditing algorithms. So do you anticipate that going forward, if this principle were to be adopted more generally, that governments would kind of take on that function and like bake these binary rules directly into the laws as they're writing them? If so, is that generally desirable or does that violate certain auditing principles?
So there's a couple of questions in there. First off, when we craft audit criteria, we are trying to mimic the law and make sure the law is well represented in these criteria, but we will also sometimes provide best practices as well. So it may not be law, it may be before the law has caught up. As we all know, the law isn't the fastest, right, in terms of keeping up with technology. So there are times when we will provide best practices. And as a function of that, we already have lawmakers asking us questions about, well, what should we do about deep fakes? What should we do about these other new interesting challenges of law? And we will provide suggestions and opinions and some policy ideas. Inside of For Humanity, we have a team called Legal Innovation, and it does exactly this kind of work, is tries to identify where the law has not quite caught up yet, and therefore, what do we suggest or what do we think? Now, should the law be binary? No, I don't think so. When we get down to binary, it's extremely inflexible, and it's done on purpose, right, to achieve compliance or non-compliance. But the nature of what we do is going to have to be iterated time and time and time and time and time again. Now, we have the ability to do that. We have the agility to do that. We have the resources and the team to do that. But the law does not. Okay. The law wants to be more generic, is not the right word. The law wants to be a little bit more circumspect, right? And identify issues and challenges and boundaries without getting too overly specific and thus inflexible. And so I think this is the balancing act. And actually, I think it's a very nice marriage of combining the legal process, which, you know, I'm not sitting here criticizing it. Even if I say it's slow, I think it's slow sometimes for very good reason, for very good process of consideration, right? Or for representing democratic values. That is slower than me being able to pull a team together of 40 industry practitioners to say the law just changed to this. How do we reflect that in a single audit criteria, which we can do much faster? So I think it's a nice combination of the two that achieves a grander function of protecting humans in two different ways of great value, to be honest. I hope that answers the question.
Oh, thank you.
Ryan, do you have any lobbying groups that you're working with to help move like regulatory action in the United States forward? Because it just seems like a massive undertaking to be trying to create these policies and then also working in Europe, in the US and elsewhere to try to figure out these standards.
It is a massive undertaking. The answer is no, not today. But that's not to say that we don't have, first off, we're only allowed a limited amount of lobbying, right? So we aren't in the business of endorsing actual proposed laws or anything like that. We will help in the discussion, the formation, and from an educational point of view, but not in the kind of official lobbying or endorsement phase. Now, we have 325 people inside of For Humanity as volunteers. What they do outside of that is kind of their business, and therefore, we may have people who are in contact with senators or state representatives or lobby firms or law firms or any sort of entity that might have some real oomph behind their opinion. And we would encourage that. And we simply want to take the tools that we have and, you know, kind of lay them in their lap and say, look, if you support this, if you view that this is valuable, please take it and talk to people about it. Can I see lobby firms getting behind this? Very possibly. Could I see lobby firms getting very against this? Absolutely. Yeah. I have this picture in my head of sitting next to Google in front of Congress talking about this, and Google basically saying, we can't do that. Like, it's going to be too hard. And ideally that we are arming our representatives or our senators to respond in the following way, which is their system is open. They take anyone, anytime, anywhere. If you didn't like it, you should have been involved in the process from the beginning.
Yeah, I feel like, especially now that we've seen how Facebook and Google have been treating their ethics board, right, their internal ethics board, and pretty much stalling any sort of progress in terms of auditing their own algorithms, it just seems like there's no way that these companies themselves are going to be open to the audit. It's going to be, I feel like we need something like the SEC saying, as a publicly traded company, you have to have these audits.
Our goal is legal mandate, same as was achieved with financial accounting. That is our goal. There's no question about it. That's where we hope to get to for the very reasons that you just cited. But in addition to that, it's funny. We are building what we call a body of knowledge repository because we want auditors who are wondering if they're staring at something like a code of ethics. Is this compliant? What can they compare it against? So it's funny, we were going through what is insufficient, sufficient, and mature for codes of ethics. And the guy who's starting this, he had Facebook in as sufficient. And our initial reaction was, we all laughed. We were like, no way, right? Like, can't be. But here's the funny thing. Their code of ethics is really good. It's very good. It's very thorough. It's very complete. It is sufficient. They just don't apply it. It's different elements of how governance, oversight, accountability work. And that's the thing is right now, Facebook can have a code of ethics and they can abide by it or not. Who's going to tell them that they didn't? Who are they abiding by it for? And who are they required to do it? Accountability means that someone must comply with something, right? That's where we want to get to. So as we build this out, there's so much to do. There's so many. We're going to do criteria for every AI, every autonomous system, everywhere in the economy that impacts a human. That's a lot.
Yeah.
I was just going to say, so the way we choose what we do next is where regulators, lawmakers, or some other control body is in a position to kind of say, you need to do this. That's kind of how we pick and choose what we do next. Sorry.
I would know, as you were talking about this, I was just thinking, I mean, I don't know if you already had this idea, but, you know, you talked about the big four accounting firms. And I was thinking, you know, a lot of these firms now have consulting arms that do focus on technology and, you know, specifically like algorithms, et cetera. I wonder if the first step could, rather than going from regulators down, to bring profit into it and kind of like somehow convince the auditing companies to include this AI audit as part of like their work, and then to use that as building momentum longer term.
So it's a great question, and I tried that model once already.
Okay.
So with the big four, basically I wanted to more perfectly replicate FASB. Yeah. So I went through a couple of the big four, and honestly, one of the big four I met, no joke, every single senior person around the world, including the global CEO and chairman.
Wow. Yeah.
Sat with the global CEO and chairman and said the following. It had an hour and 10 minutes and got, you know, this the whole time. We need to do this. Yes, we need to do this. And then we finished and I said, you get to lead this. You can announce this. But oh, by the way, you have to invite the other three to the table. And that's when the head did this. they're just not in a position, in a willingness to recognize that broader scope. And oh, by the way, the global head of assurance, which is the audit side of the house, said to me not but 3 months before, we are not qualified to do these audits. And he was right. The amount of training, the difference between auditing numbers and tax code and law versus ethics, bias, privacy, trust, and cybersecurity is a monumental difference in training. Yeah. So what that taught me by going through that process is it's actually better to meet the law where it is with the regulators in a smaller subset, prove the model in a couple of places first, grow the crowd, grow the capability and process. And what's going to happen? See, the ICO hasn't even approved our first GDPR certification scheme. They promised in January. It hasn't arrived yet. Once they do, honestly, it's going to be dominoes. Because first off, all of the EU was basically going to say, yep, we approve that scheme. We've also submitted something called the Children's Code, which is a magnificent gold standard law in the UK around age-appropriate design. And we've submitted a certification scheme for that as well. And the demand for protection of children around the world in these spaces is really high. So we think that once this approval comes down, it's going to be like wildfire for this one to catch on. So I think that's as good an approach as possible. The big four are starting to get involved with For Humanity because they know they have to move here, but you're right, it's the consultant side of the house, not the audit side of the house. And it's because the consultants are the ones that have the skill in AI and autonomous systems.
Outstanding. And so awesome. We've got a couple more questions that I hope that we can get to. Before we time out, one from Valeria related to the, what should the cadence be? And Valeria, maybe I'll let you ask the question. And then speaking of cadence, if we have time, which would be great. The next question would be from Chris, and I share it in part, but it relates to this side conversation we've been having, Ryan, on the recent Wyoming law for decentralized autonomous organization type of LLC. And so an autonomous legal entity, one version of which is algorithmically managed, which may mean that the algorithm is making all the material decisions for a corporation. Could independent audit maybe be part of the toolkit for how to contain the risk of that? And then obviously, I know you have opinions about whether that's wise to start with. But first things first, Valeria, thank you so much, and you have the floor.
Thank you, Daniel, Taza. My question is related to the fact that there are different types of AI systems. So, for example, the European Union recently is talking about this problem. So, for example, there is the recent proposal from the European Commission, but before there was also a resolution from the European Parliament. And it's interesting because they divide the AI system in different risks. So there is high risk there. So for example, if you are talking about AI system related to that operates in a road facilities related to credit score and so on, they are high risk or there are less risk AI systems. So for example, video games, they have a way less risk compared to other. Yes. So my question is, if in this case, the auditing in this case uses a sort of proportionality principle in the context of the frequency of examination. So for example, if a high level here AI system is evaluated more often, if there is this such of debate or if it's yep. not considered. Thank you.
No, 100%. Everything we do is risk-based. We actually want to start from a different direction, which is we want to identify low risk. And we want to get it off the table for compliance. We know we have a fixed set of resources just as people, right? As a world, we have a fixed set of resources. And what we want to do is we want to identify what is low risk and get it out of the way. When it comes to what the EU proposed, they said high risk and everything else. We don't see it that way. We see it as systemic risk, in which case we don't even think it should exist. High risk, medium risk, and low, where high and medium, as long as they have sufficient mitigations, can be allowed to go forward. And so I think part of also of your question is just understanding how criteria are built. We build them two ways. From the top down, governance. So we have a set of criteria that belong to board of directors, CEO, chief data officer. These criteria are governance, oversight, accountability. They apply to every AI, every autonomous system, regardless of what it is. But after that, we actually go system by system all throughout the C-suite. So we assign things to chief operations officer, chief technology officer, head of HR, so on. And we identify the systems in specific because we want to look at those systems to see what is unique about them, again, in ethics, bias, privacy, trust, and cyber, that we need to or may need to consider in terms of dedicated criteria. So when we respond to the EU, the new EU regs, we actually on May 17th, they're launching a group that will do a series of things. First is that we will craft criteria from the top down that fit the EU demand for governance, oversight, and accountability. Once we finish with that, we will then move to Annex 3 and we will go function by function by function and create audits for every single one of those identified high risk AIs. So I hope, Valeria, that answered your question.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Valeria. I was wondering that too. And just as a quick reflection, lately I've been working a lot in DevOps and automated testing of systems, you know, as they get released on nightly builds. And, you know, some of the criteria have some overlap with some of the criteria that you're doing auditing on. And it just made me start to wonder how much of could we have as continuous audit in a sense, as opposed to these events that people get ready for? Some stuff obviously needs a team of humans and a review and conversation and everything, but some of the information, because it is AI, it's already captured in terms of what the rules are and how they're being applied and the result.
Yeah, fantastic question. And he froze, so I'm not sure. Oh, he's back though.
Oh, sorry.
No, you're good. I think I heard it all. So when we build the criteria, it's built from design to decommissioning. And it also includes some internal real-time monitoring. So for example, when we talk about a model that is built with a specific scope, nature, context, and purpose, right? According to GDPR, if you're using consent as your frame for lawful basis, then it has to be consistent with scope, nature, context, and purpose. Therefore, if your model is a learning algorithm and it's going to change and move, what we have to do, and we require this in our audit criteria, are key performance indicators, guardrails around that model to identify when concept drift has occurred. And therefore you've left the scope, nature, context, and purpose for which you had good consent for. So there's design all the way to decommissioning, there's criteria all along the way. As those learn this process, they will build it into how they design and develop. There's nothing that we're asking for that isn't part of good design, governance, oversight, documentation, and so on. So the idea of continuous audit sort of, I basically am in agreement. And then on top of that, there are already groups inside of For Humanity who are building compliance by design systems that want to capture all of this all of the time, sort of replicating that internal audit system where it was just, you know, feeding the compliance as needed. We want to get to that same place, but now the compliance is automatically captured and be able to be delivered to that external auditor for verification. And if the systems are robust enough, we could have more frequent reviews. Right now, we stand by an annual review. Here's the problem with an annual review. If you do an annual review, you could be out of best practice the next day. So you've got 364 days when you're not best practice or when you're not up to scratch with the law that's changed. And that's suboptimal. But at the same time, it's also in some ways practical because some of the solutions to these issues are capital intensive, they're investment decisions, they take time to implement. So having some sort of lag in the process is reasonable to achieve compliance. So I think that's the balance of your question, Daza.
Outstanding. And so now for very quickly, how about the whole new, you know, half day seminar worth of content on corp bots and automated LLCs? And then for extra credit, if you can get to it, I know David, hardly a podcast goes by where he doesn't raise the specter of the robot lawyer and the law practice of the future, right? Yeah. That's algorithmic largely. How on earth are we going to start auditing algorithmic organizations and service providers and professionals?
Well, I think we have the system to require the disclosure, transparency, documentation of all of these systems. There's nothing unique about these particular algorithmic entities that couldn't meet the demands of what we are requiring for compliance. So I think it applies in the same fashion. However, coming from the very simple perspective of For Humanity and ensuring that humans are best served, I get the idea of smart contracts. I get the idea of automated decisions and speed to market tools. All of that makes sense to me. Here's what I'm worried about. There's also an element of control. And I'm going to use a very sci-fi sort of example here. But if you don't have ultimate control, what we could see is a poorly optimized machine without embedded values and risks, which is essentially operating against societal views, ethics, and so on, and becomes problematic to the community around it. So when we talk about ethical systems, we talk about impacts on humans, but also on society at large, systemic risk, environmental, and so on. What I think is a better system, and I wrote this years ago, and this could be changed over time, but I would argue that there should always be a human beneficial owner who we could jail or who we could separate from the entity to slow things down, to maximize that control. There's a whole world out there that believes in something called the stop button problem, that there are certain machines, certain algorithms that we can build that we cannot stop. And so insisting upon some sort of framework, and you know, we can make jokes like, oh, well, you just unplug it. Well, yes, we unplug it until the machine in Transcendence, that Johnny Depp movie, goes out and finds a different power source, right? And yes, it's very science fiction, but let's plan for it today to ensure that we have robust human control over the tools that we have. And we aren't allowing a machine to have its own raison d'etre, if you would, okay? And so from a group called For Humanity, you could see why we would have this sort of perspective. Daza, do you think that answered the question?
I think that answered the question in the way that raises more questions, which is the way we like it. And so any kind of closing reflections or the last word goes to our esteemed co-host, David Horrigan.
Thank you, Daza. And Ryan, thank you for sharing these insights today. It's been truly fascinating. And we will see people, especially in the legal work that I do, are very interested in how artificial intelligence is going to apply. And the interesting thing to me is that it really has been applied for years. People just haven't thought about it like they are now. So thank you for being here with us.
My pleasure. It's an honor to speak with each of you and great questions. And it was great fun.
Thank you. TMA, can you take us out in your customary manner, please?
Thanks again, Ryan. And thank you all for coming today. And we'll see you guys next month at the next IdeaFlow. Bye.